Factors such as cost and function influence the design of a bridge.
If you are unable to complete the task in time, please notify me by email.
It's important that humans dispose of their waste in appropriate ways.
Detailed analysis of population growth has revealed some alarming predictions.
The study showed that people's mood can be affected by news and weather reports.
It is important that you work as a team on this project.
Please switch off all electronic devices when you are attending a conference session.
Please note that the college laboratories will be closed.
The financial report for the last quarter will be available this afternoon.
In today's lecture, I'm going to talk about changes in air pollution since the middle of the last century and what has created these changes. So, by the 1950s, air pollution was very visible, with frequent thick black fogs known as smogs in many large cities around the world. The main source of this pollution was from factories, and it caused severe health problems. For example, a particularly severe smog in London in 1952 caused over 4,000 deaths. Obviously, something had to be done. And in 1956, a Clean Air Act was introduced in Britain. This addressed the pollution from factories, and the smog soon disappeared. However, as you know, these days air pollution is still a big issue. The main difference between now and the 1950s is that you can't see it. It's invisible. Also, the main source of pollution now is from cars and lorries, and although these don't produce visible signs, this air pollution is still a significant risk to health. And one of the key factors in the rise of this type of pollution is that we have all become much more vehicle dependent. There are far more cars and lorries, trains and planes than in the 1950s, and this is now the main source of air pollution around the world.
Okay, to help you with your research, I just wanted to give you some tips today on using focus groups. These are groups of people that you get together to find out about their opinions and attitudes, for example, to review a piece of work, or just basically provide some collective input to help you with whatever you're researching. First of all, how large should a focus group be? Well, I would say that an ideal number of participants is around 6 or 7. If it's any bigger, what quite often happens is they break into side conversations and the focus is lost. If it's any smaller, you may not get the range of views that you need to get a really good discussion. Secondly, it's important that you have a moderator for the group who's able to facilitate and guide the discussions. The moderator must ensure that everyone participates and stop anyone dominating. And also, the moderator needs to make sure that the discussions don't go off in the wrong direction. And thirdly, in order to help the group focus on what's required, some basic materials should be used, particularly to kick-start the discussions. This may be in the form of pictures, photos, diagrams, graphs, etc., and will help the group to understand the context of what needs to be discussed.
Hello, everyone. Today's lecture is about setting up a website. I'm going to be focusing on things that you need to consider to ensure your website really adds value to the people using it. So, there are three main areas you need to think about. The first and most important thing is who is your target audience. When you're creating a new website, you really need to think about who the users are and what information they'll be looking for. What we do when we set up websites is to group users based on their needs. So, for a website in the academic community, for example, we may have groups such as researchers and administrators, and this helps us design the site and add information that is relevant to each group. The second point is accessibility. The main thing here is to ensure your website can be found. And you can do this by making sure it can be reached from areas on the web where your target audience are also active. So this may mean providing links on other websites or maybe using social media. And thirdly, retention. making sure your target audience return to your website regularly. You do this by ensuring it gives them a reason to come back, so it's important to keep the site up to date and make sure it provides the latest news and interesting information and so on.
Which section of a train timetable will tell you what time your train leaves?
What do we call the list of steps that tell you how to put something together?
What do we call the meeting where an employer asks a potential employee questions about their work experience?
What desk should you go to when you first arrive to stay at a hotel?
What is the job title of someone who designs buildings?
What term is used for the amount of money you pay a landlord for living in their house or apartment?
What do we call the first meal of the day?
What word is used for someone who watches a sports event?
What object would you use to climb up to the roof of a house?
If you don't feel like eating, what do we say you don't have?